brought to you by Penguin.
Studying Dracula, the complete text and revision guide by Bram Stoker, with revision material by Priya Christie, read by Roger May and Roy McMillan. Welcome to Studying Dracula, the complete text and revision guide. We begin this audiobook with a detailed analysis of the novel, covering an introduction, genre and context, style and narrative treatment, characters and main themes. We then move on to the full, unabridged narration of the novel itself, with chapter summaries throughout. Introduction. It is useful as a starting point to think about the novel using a simple binary, the triumph of good over evil. The scientific methods of Van Helsing and Dr. Seward, coupled with their faith in the saving power of God, means that Count Dracula is soundly defeated and the threat of Eastern European influence which he symbolizes is removed. Society can then be reinstated in the classic model of the Victorian family unit, in the form of the Harkers. Binaries are neat, predictable, and fit nicely with the Victorian sensibility that the natural order will prevail. Yet to hold on to the binary here would be to ignore the fundamental fact that the novel is an unreliable creation, composed entirely of epistles and diary entries with hardly one authentic document. Dracula has been rendered so unstable that it unsettles man's conception of himself as whole and uncorrupted. The presence of an organizing principle, be it God or society or indeed the novel form itself, is an illusion. This instability is presented in a number of ways. Lucy Westenra disrupts the comforting idea of the good British woman when she turns into the Bloofer Lady. Characters also face bouts of madness. Renfield believes he can absorb life force by drinking the blood of small animals. Jonathan Harker suffers from a nervous breakdown after his encounter with Dracula. Finally, even though the novel is called Dracula, we never actually get to hear from the vampire. He is always described or represented by the other characters in So Wild a Story. Like the novel itself, the Count is a malleable construct and will be whatever the characters need him to be. But surely the defeat of Dracula heralds the return of Victorian values. It would, except the character's very claim to be the defenders of morality is severely compromised by their savage actions that include desecrating the corpse of a woman beloved by them all. As the text progresses, it becomes more difficult to cling to the good-evil binary, as it becomes obvious that the very pursuit of morality necessitates acts of profound evil. The behavior of the vampire, too, closely resembles the behavior of the English gentleman. Even the novel's Madonna, Mina, is not spared the humiliation of corruption when the host burns her forehead. Every single character journeys into evil's lair, which suggests they were never really that good to begin with. Reading this novel means that we become increasingly comfortable with the fact that we are dealing with fractured forms and fractured selves that are only loosely being held together by the threads of civility. Physical, psychological, and bodily spaces are invaded to reveal the tension between how the Victorians were versus how the Victorians wanted to see themselves. Good and evil do not exist as a binary, but as a continuum. Man must decide where his place is in this continuum and accept that any quest for stability will lead to the unsettling discovery that there is none to be found. Not within society, and, as it turns out, not within literature. Genre and context. A Gothic reimagining takes place in the late 19th century, when writers such as Oscar Wilde, Robert Louis Stevenson, as well as Bram Stoker himself, bring the genre home. The Portrait of Dorian Gray, 1890, depicts the unnatural desires of Dorian Gray, an aristocratic hedonist who wants his youth and beauty to prevail. He pursues a libertine lifestyle and does not age a day, but his portrait, which he hides in the attic, registers every vile sin and putrefies in the frame. The Strange Case of Dr. Jekyll and Mr. Hyde, published in 1886, portrays the split personality of the respectable Dr. Jekyll, where a murderous and terrifying alter ego is unleashed. These late Victorian works continue the Gothic tradition of portraying a pleasurable kind of terror, with one notable addition. Evil not only enters the British capital and the British family, but also the British soul, and perhaps that evil has been there all along. Victorian concerns as to the fluidity of gender roles, the decay and degradation of the British upper class, the rise of capitalism, and the increasing worry that London was being overrun by Eastern Europeans are neatly woven in with more traditional markers of the Gothic genre, such as the use of an ancient castle and the supernatural. This makes Dracula a uniquely late Victorian Gothic construction, and it's necessary to consider Stoker's choice of genre in tandem with the topical issues of the era. The 1800s saw Britain ruling the waves as a naval power, but all this came to a sad end later in the century. British influence was waning, while Germany and the United States enjoyed their time of political and economic importance. Victorian confidence had turned into Victorian anxiety, and this anxiety manifested itself in narratives, where British men and women had to struggle to protect themselves from assault by a foreign power. Fears around immigration culminated in the Aliens Act of 1905, investing the government with the power to prevent the landing of undesirable immigrants. Stoker's immigrant is not just undesirable, he's also bestial. This creates a double vulnerability. The coloniser has become the colonised, and the coloniser is an unevolved creature with the power to destroy society. To the British gentleman, Dracula is a monster, but the idea of monstrosity is subjective. To the canary, even a fluffy house cat can appear monstrous. This is a sombre reminder to the civilised British that to the conquered peoples of the British Empire, they too were seen as monsters. Count Dracula, monster though he may be, operates using economically recognizable codes, primarily those of early capitalism. We must ask a very important question when we read this novel. Why does Dracula come to England? He confesses to Jonathan Harker that he invited him to his castle so that he could better understand the nuances of the British legal system and to acquire property in London. The vampire threat moves abroad precisely because Count Dracula, like the Victorian industrialists of his time, gravitated towards money-making opportunities. Count Dracula is the epitome of the feudal leader. He is from an old family who sits on vast quantities of inherited wealth and allows gypsies to live and work on his land. Yet even he recognizes that he needs to modernize himself and adapt to a new mode of wealth generation. He purchases properties in strategic locations all over London, and the manner in which he arranges and organizes the shipment and delivery of his coffins is exemplary. Even Jonathan Harker expresses his admiration for the Count's business acumen when he declares that everything had been carefully thought out and done systematically and with precision. The shrewd, blood-sucking businessman, pardon the pun, is really a vampire. Stoker evokes a nightmarish vision where the Count comes to London not just to increase his holdings, but also to create a new and ever-widening circle of semi-demons to batten on the helpless. By the Darwinian logic of survival of the fittest, immortal and undead vampires win. The decaying morality of the British upper class acts as a clarion call for Dracula. Lucy Westenra, with her three marriage proposals and girlish delight for sensuality and romance, becomes an easy target for the Count. The thing about vampirism, which no one really admits, is that people who succumb to its influence very much want to. Harker wants the vampire women to have their way with him. Lucy wants to throw off the restraints of Victorian morality, and Arthur wants to embrace his voluptuous, wanton vampire fiancée. Upper-class pretensions and traditions fly in the face of vampiric desire, and an entire social system teeters on the brink of collapse. Nowhere is this collapse more clearly seen than in the novel's treatment of gender issues. In Stoker's society.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.